loves, welcome back to the Get Loved Up podcast, your number one resource for inspiration and motivation to live your purpose, make healthy living a priority, and thrive doing what you love. I'm your host, Koya Webb, a small town girl who chased her dreams and caught them, a former track and field athlete who healed using spirituality and yoga, and an entrepreneur who didn't let sexual assault, racism, and insecurities dim her light. And now it's your turn to allow these episodes with some of the top voices in spirituality, wellness, and entrepreneurship to inspire you to thrive. Let's get loved up together. Anthony Trucks is a former NFL athlete, American Ninja Warrior on NBC, international speaker, host of the All Shift podcast, and the founder of Identity Shift Coaching. He uses cutting-edge science and psychology to upgrade how you operate so you can elevate your life and business to reach your full potential. After being given away into foster care at 3 years old, being adopted into an all-white family at 14, losing his NFL career to injury, and more, he learned how to shift at a very young age, and now his life mission is teaching others how to make shift happen in their lives. Anthony!
We're here.
Just to give you all context, we are at a mastermind in Napa Valley, and seeing you in person, I mean, you're dynamic. You are dynamic, like online, on social media, but seeing you in person and just the energy and the presence that you hold is it's just phenomenal to be in your presence.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
And I'm just so excited because I feel like a lot of people right now are struggling with their identity and trying to figure out who they are, especially after this time during the pandemic. And so you are kind of like the go-to to help people find their identity.
Yeah.
But first I want to start with yours because you didn't have a regular childhood. Can you start a little bit about your childhood and what it meant for you growing up adopted and how that really set the tone for your identity?
Yeah, well, it's all of it, right? All the tone set there. It's because I think all of us have developmental years. Like there's that stage of life where we're trying to figure out who we are and where we fit and, you know, kind of where the future might be. And so for me in those stages, there's actually a lot of foundation built there for every single person. But for me, it was not the greatest, right? So you kind of have a situation where my mom gives me away into foster care and I have three siblings, we're all shipped off. And you get to this initial moment for me of like the first memory of feeling less than. And at some point we all get there. We all get to the point of like, oh, the relationship fell apart or, you know, something happened in school. But like, this was the beginning and it was like your own mom. So you start off with this, I'm not even good enough for my mom kind of feeling. And then you go into the situation of foster care, which in that world, you're what's called a paycheck. And a paycheck simply says, as long as I don't die, these people can do whatever they want. And obviously they get paid for it. So I was beaten, I was starved, I was tortured. So now I feel like less than human. And then you eventually, you know, you press forward in my life to where I'm at 6 years old. It was only 3 years in a system like this. 6 years old, like the sixth house, and are all bad. I land in one that's my current family now at 6 years old. The difference is it was the first family that was all whites. As this black person, an all-white family, very poor, in a non-diverse area. Like I get pictures from my high school or, you know, buddies who were like friends at elementary that are like, I'm the only guy in the whole school. All the pictures that looks like me. So I never have a sense of stability. And at home, it was always awkward because I'm one of eight, but it's like, you know, table for seven. So never really felt like I fit in. And so that was like the developmental like foundation of my identity was like, well, you don't matter. You know, even the people taking care of you don't care about you because it just was weird. But in that family, they loved me, but it still, I almost didn't let them love me. Mm. It's an interesting dynamic of like in those realms of kids, most people don't know that when you're in foster care, you just want to go home.
Right.
So even though this person that your real mom is not good for you, that's all I desire.
Right.
And so it's back and forth consistently of like, where am I? Where do I fit? So yeah, it wasn't very fun. And I wish I could say like, oh, I got adopted at 14, which I did. And life was amazing. But like, even then, whole new trajectory of like difference and identity. And so I've been battling it my entire life. It's been this conversation and it wasn't until probably like 2017, I started making more of a kind of a clear understanding of it for myself, like who I was and where I fit and why things happen. And then in doing that for myself, I was like, oh, other people have identities and other people have similar struggles. What if I could like find a way to codify it and make it like a process? So that's kind of what led me to the work I do. But it all stems from my own life. You know, there's a lot we haven't even covered yet, but there's a lot within the journey that is a human experience.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that. I know that's not, you had to work to be able to share that part of your past. And, you know, when you said I had to let them love me, or you weren't letting them love me, like, what opened your heart to love?
There are parts of life where you meet certain people that don't make sense. And most of the time when you say it doesn't make sense, it's like, this person doesn't make sense, like in a negative way. Mm-hmm. For me in that situation, as a foster kid who didn't want anybody to love me, it was this thing where like you try to do things to go home. So when I say I want to go home to my mom, it wasn't like I sat there idly doing nothing.
Right.
Like you do things. It's like, how can I progress this faster, right? So mm-hmm. maybe if I'm bad in school, maybe if I act out at home.
Right.
And my adoptive mom, her name is Gina Renee Hart, whenever I was there, like she loved me at a level that didn't make sense. Mm. Like when you think about like unconditional love, there are certain things that like, I love my kid no matter what. And there are people 100% do, right? But I wasn't her real kid, right? So it didn't make sense. Like, why would you go to bat for me like this? It was just weird. And eventually at this point of like, she really loves me. Mm-hmm. In fact, in the foster care system, by the time I turned about 14, I knew like that they got paid for me, right? Prior to that, like they didn't tell me, but they were trying to adopt me years before when they knew they loved me, which means they were willing to like say, hey, I'm gonna keep the same kid here. We could have him not be our kid, but still get a paycheck for years. Or we could say, we love him, let's keep him, screw the money. And so while other families wanted me for a paycheck, they in fact like fought to get me to be adopted. So like it was a point in time where I was like, oh wow, they really love me.
Right.
And that was where I started having the sense of like opening to the idea that like I was worthy in some capacity. So yeah, she loved me past my crazy. She was the one that helped me kind of get out of that bubble of I don't matter, nobody cares, because someone actually did.
Right. That's so beautiful. That's so beautiful that you felt that at that age. And even though you had all of this pain from being abused, mm-hmm. basically as a child, there was some part of you that knew what love felt like, even though it wasn't your real mother.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so when that, you know, the pain still doesn't go away.
No, it doesn't disappear.
So once you felt that love, how long did it take for you to really start to see the difference in how you behave? Like, were you still just like, you know what, had this sense of I don't fit in, I don't belong, mm-hmm. and a sense of not connecting with others around you? Or was it mostly within your family?
So I think, there's like a two part to it, right? So on one hand, you do have that anchor, right? So I have this family that loves me. That's the first part of it. And a lot of people have family that love them, right? But then you also have this part where you go into the world. And the world, you spend a lot of time in the world, so you also want to be accepted by the world. So while I did get that base of like, I have a home, I didn't still have that sense of like, I want to make sure I matter and have value to the world. And so I didn't have anything to really give me a sense of knowing that I had that. So I went out into the world, and man, the world's a vicious place, you know, because so my first effort, you know, towards trying to develop that sense of I have value was like, I'm going to play the sport of football.
Right.
Because, you know, as a kid growing up, I go to elementary school, all my classmates got jerseys and everything, but I wasn't allowed to play because of just the situation with my biological mom. So then I could go play. So now I go and try it and I'm horrible. Mm-hmm. And a lot of us, we try these new things and we're met with the reality of like, I suck at this. And then you have to like, okay, well, it's emotionally painful.
Yeah.
And so what we do is we either subject ourselves to that again, which just seems masochistic, like you can keep doing this, right? Mm-hmm. Or you just walk away and make a good excuse. Here's why it took place. I wasn't that good. And we just never revisit it. And so for me, I did. Like I did try again one more year. So 2 years in, I'm like, I'm bad at this. And I'm like, this is not for me, you know? So I had family at home. My mom got diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, my adoptive mom's. So like that was the thing that was going on there. Then I was like, I still want to find myself. And I was like, I'm a foster kid, man. I'm not supposed to have a great life. So I just kind of was like, I'm gonna chuck it out and just kind of walk away. And in my family, no one goes to college. We barely graduate high school. Like I'm the only one to graduate from the high school on time without continuation or a GED. Out of all my 6 siblings. And then so like in my mom, I don't think she even graduated. I think she had a GED later. So it's like not the thing for us. And I was going right along with the rest of it. And then what ended up happening was I had this moment, and this is one moment in middle school, it was actually elementary, I'm sorry, high school. I went through all of them, but the one it was. Got to high school, Mr. Howe's English class. And I'm sitting in the back desk and these two girls are talking and I'm checked out at this point, right? So football, not gonna happen. Mom is sick. I'm just this guy, you know, navigating, kind of be a statistic. And two girls are having this conversation. No idea I'm listening. And one says to the other one, well, the reason I'm so bad is because I'm in foster care. Right, this really interesting little like statement. It's not much. At face value, it's like, oh, okay, like simple. But when you have that excuse rattling around in your head quietly and you hear it out loud,
right,
it's like, oh, like that. That's not a real good excuse. Mm-hmm. It'd be like someone saying, oh, the reason I didn't eat good foods because, well, McDonald's was so close. Like, that's a stupid excuse. Like, that's not a real valid one.
Right.
So it unsettled me. And I remember I went home that day after school and I made this commitment to myself, like, you're going to be great.
Yeah.
And, 15 years old, you don't know what great is. I'm like, so I was like, football, let's try football. Mm-hmm. So that was like the first step of me building into the efforts of what it took to be great at that thing so I could return the investment of what you're talking about, feeling like I had acceptance and value. And so right. I did. I gave all of myself to this thing to be great before I knew I'd be great. Mm. But in doing so, like, I got this sense of self. And it wasn't I came out some amazing athlete, but I had this sense inside of, like, this is what I deserve.
Right.
I'd done too much work in the dark for you to take what was mine in the light now.
Mm.
Like, I'm taking this.
That's powerful.
Yeah, and I owned it. And so that's what showed up, is a sense of value that I've never lost completely. I got the bottoms, but right. I still realized, like, I was deserving of some things.
I think that's so important, because a lot of people just feel like you felt in the beginning, that they're not worthy. Mm-hmm. That they, well, because I was dealt this hand, life is just going to be hard for me. Mm-hmm. But I believe, we all deserve the best life has to offer. But yeah. First, we have to do what you did. Like, just claim it. Just say and acknowledge and affirm, mm-hmm. I deserve it.
Yeah.
I deserve it. And so how did your life shift once you said, you know what, I deserve this. I'm going to go try this football thing and see if it works.
Yeah, well, there's a statement I say of like, it's tied to human investment, right? Mm-hmm. If we invest something, we want to return. Yeah. All of us do. If I invest money, I want money back. If I invest in raising this kid, I want to have a kid that's respectful, right? I want to return. So the interesting thing is when you invest in hard work, the return of the investment is a sense of ownership, sense of deserving, right?
Right.
Whether or not it's right is relative to the situation, the person, we put that out there. It's all different, right? Because my hard work's different than somebody else's.
Mm-hmm.
However, the return on the investment of effort into football returned not just a better skilled player, but that sense of deserving. And what happened was I got to this level, and we all get this level of the return's confidence,
right.
Self-esteem, joy. So for me, I'd say what you create creates you.
Mm.
So in the process of creation, I'm creating me. And so most people get to that point of not feeling like doing anything, and I just don't want to do anything. Like, the longer you stay there,
Mm-hmm.
So what I did was I created this sense of self, and I built into it, and it showed up in a different way, and it turned my life around. So now I have this sense of confidence, and this bravado. Might have been a little cocky, a football player.
You need a little cockiness as a football player. You just got to have a little edge.
If you go in the field and they see you sweat, like, they will kill you. and so, yeah, just it turned into 2 years later, getting a college football scholarship and, progressed on past that. But it turned into this thing where, like, I felt like when I would go out there, it went from this thing that was painful before.
Mm-hmm.
Realized I hated doing it because it was so painful.
Right.
So I had joy doing it.
Mm.
Like, I used to wear this, it's weird. When we had like white jerseys, I had a black arm sleeve.
Mm.
And black jerseys, I'd do a white. So I'd do like, different colors. So black and white was reversed in the sleeve arm. And I did it because I wanted other teams to know who I was when they saw me at a distance.
Mm.
And it sounds odd, like I was playing around, but like, no, I had that level of confidence.
That's amazing. Yeah, they're like, just know I'm here, so you might want to go the opposite way.
Yeah, that's just what it was. I mean, it was, it's like when the team's walking out, like, because you're in high school, you don't know who's who.
Yeah.
Who's the number one? But like, you saw me. Like, you saw us walking on the line, that's the guy.
That's amazing, especially coming from that childhood, just wanting to be seen, wanting to people to recognize who you are and value you.
Mm-hmm.
And do you feel like, after playing football and going to the NFL, did you then feel valued?
It's ups and downs.
Mm-hmm.
I think life provides that for you because it's momentary, sometimes great heights and then deep bottoms.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I mean, I went to college and I felt great. I was on billboards and, I took my high school sweetheart. We went up there, had a kid, met my real dad, my first collegiate start, like found him at like 20 years old, met him at 21.
So and what did that mean? I mean, we can't just gloss over.
There's a lot in this story. Yeah,
meeting
yeah.
your dad.
Yeah.
At that age, mm-hmm. after you've had some success,
mm-hmm.
like how did that really make you feel, and what did that mean for you to meet your father?
Yeah, it meant a lot. So I didn't know his last name. My mm-hmm. my biological mom's white, so I'm half and half. But you wouldn't look at me and think mixed.
Mm-hmm.
So like, how did that take place? And my birth certificate has an Irish last name.
Wow.
Wow. So it burns. I'm like, I'm obviously, there's something off, right?
So you didn't know?
No idea.
Until you met him.
Yeah. And so when I got to college, my biological grandmother, she eventually, like, I pulled out my dad's name from her. She finally gave it to me.
Wow.
Look him up on the internet. There were three in the country. And they lived in Marietta, Georgia. We were planning it's Mississippi State my next year. And I'm a freshman.
Right.
So I'm like, well, if I'm going to meet my dad, I might want to be like starting. That'd be cool. I had to go up against a fifth year senior. So wow. His fifth year, my second. And it's his time for the job. He's been fighting and waiting, right? I'm like, I want the job. Like, like I want this job. And so it was one of the most hard-fought battles I've ever had in my life, you know, in terms of like for a position. And I earned it.
Right.
So like my sophomore year, true sophomore year, I started, played against Mississippi State, national television. I got a game ball. And, like, I got to meet my real dad. Interesting thing is, like, at the time, he had no idea I existed.
Wow.
You know, my mom just didn't tell him, all that kind of stuff. And then 9 years later, before he passed away, he goes, hey, I did know about you all your life. So weird bubble in that whole
situation.
Wow.
Okay, hold up. Because this has happened to me before. And it's such a interesting thing.
Yeah.
So what did that mean to you for him to tell you? Were you happy that he was honest before he passed? Or were you just like super confused? Like, why would you do that? Like, what kind of feeling did that leave you with?
It depends on what they say. There's a statement is you can never step in the same river twice because river's not the same, nor is the man.
Mm.
So at that moment in time when he stepped in the river was the right time.
Mm. Into your life when you first met.
Yeah. Well, not even into my life, but when he told me how. Because when he came in my life, it was a time where I didn't have a need, you know, like I had a son this time. It was kind of cool. Like, I got a son. Like, I know your true grandpa. Like, I have an older sister, younger brothers. I was born out of wedlock, I came to find. And you know, it was like this, he has no idea. So like, I didn't feel as bad. I'm like, it's cool. Like, he's apologetic, you know? Had he told me then, I definitely would have had a different reaction.
That makes sense.
Had he had told me a year earlier, when he finally told me, I would have had a different reaction.
Mm.
I mean, literally the story progresses to a point of, like, he couldn't have picked a better window.
Wow.
And honest, he told me because he was passing away. And I didn't even know. I found out after the fact that he had passed away. No one in the family had told me. No one communicate with me, right? So it was an interesting thing of, like, when he did, I had a lot of life going on, but it was like the perfect time for him to have the conversation.
Mm.
And I'm also glad because say he says it a year earlier, and I fly off the handle, which very well could have happened. Well, now he goes to his grave with that weight.
Mm-hmm.
And I go to my rest of my life with that weight of knowing I didn't rectify.
Right.
So, like, I have a great deal of peace and, like, appreciation knowing that God put that in my life at the right time, in the right manner, in the right way, to where neither of us had to live our lives in that manner.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. And what part does spirituality play in your life? Because, you know, a big part of Get Loved Up is spirituality, well-being, and entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I know you reference God. So what part do you feel like your spiritual guidance has played in how your life has developed thus far?
Yeah, huge part. Like, I grew up in the family with, like, you know, we're Christians on, like, Easter and Sunday, you know, Easter and like, Christmas Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't this thing where I had, like, a really true base until I was, like, 18. Mm-hmm. And I went to this, in football, they take you up to colleges, you do these recruiting trips, you go up there and you fly around. So I went to Washington State, my first trip. It was, like, my senior year. I'm about to head off to college pretty soon. You know, I'm going to pick the college and take off. And so I go up there, and they give you this guy to show you around. And they end up getting called, like, what do they call him? Like, your, I don't know. I can't think of your person who shows you around, your guide, we'll call it. I can't think of what it is. And so I go up there, and the guy's like, he's taking me around. And as he's taking me around, he's my host. That's what it was, host. And we go to this party. And it was weird because I'm like, I have a girlfriend at home, my high school sweetheart. Like, we're very close, great relationship. I think because of the situation with my mom, me and women have, like, a tight, like, bond when I'm with that woman. Like, there's no penetrating into my space. And so I was tight with her. And then I go to this house, and it's like a house party, and the guys go in the back, take them to the back. Hey, trucks, pick one. I'm like, you know, and then out of the blue, a guy named Chris Hurd comes walking out. Chris isn't the kind of guy to be at these places. He's a guy that was, it was my high school crosstown rivals quarterback the year before.
Mm-hmm.
He was at Washington State as quarterback. He's like, hey, trucks, maybe you want to head out here? I was like, yeah, let's get out of here. My whole reason for being even looked at was because of Chris. He'd come home in the offseason, went and told his coaches, like, hey, I threw the ball with this guy. He's pretty good. They took a look at me, like, hey, take a look. So going on there, he's like, let's get out of here. We go and take a walk to the stadium, go to the top of the stadium, and we look around. He goes, hey, man, how's your, like, relationship with, like, faith? Mm-hmm. I was like, why do you ask? He says, well, you're about to step into this world. We're going to be away from home. You're going to have a lot of freedom, a lot of opportunity. There's going to be a lot of things happen. And if you don't take any kind of control, you can get spun up in the world. Mm. I was like, interesting. He's like, so he's like, you know, just, you may look at like having a base of faith that's helped me amazingly. And that was it. He didn't pray with me, nothing, just had a conversation. So I fly home the next day, like the day or day after, but I fly home, and they always take it with, you know, an airport taxi takes from the airport to your house. They book it. So I get outside, I walk out, there's a guy holding a sheet of paper, my name on it, this burgundy van, he's, you know, guy just wearing regular clothes, olive skin, like short brown hair, and I'm dead serious, the guy looked like Jesus. Like he had that, he had that look. Maybe he did it on purpose, I don't know. But I get in the van, he didn't even say a hi, he says, hey, are you saved? Mm. First question, are you saved? I go, it's so weird you just said that. I just left, a conversation took place. I said, no, I'm not, but I it's a discussion. He goes, do you mind if I just kind of share my testimony? So for the next hour and a half driving home from San Francisco to Antioch, he just pours in, tells me a story. And then we get to like right around the corner from my house. We stop on the street. He says, do you mind if I, you know, pray with you to accept Christ? And so I did. And at that moment, it was this thing where like the world kind of spun differently for me. Mm. The perspective of how I showed up in the world and something being bigger than me and what was right and wrong outside of how I felt about what felt right and felt wrong. Because what feels right isn't always easy, right? But if you lean in that direction, it makes things hard. So like, I know right and wrong. I have a faith base, and that's been a humongous like piece. When I played in the NFL, I didn't even cuss. Mm. Like it was just like, it was anchored. And even in college, same thing. So been a huge piece. At one point, like business-wise, when I first started out, I had a gym after the NFL, and after everything went crazy, and I wasn't doing very well. And I went to lunch with my pastor. I was like, tell him what's going on. He goes, hey, have you ever considered making God your business partner?
Wow.
Yeah, I was like, what do you mean? He goes, you know, if you think about it, like, you're trying to do this on your own, it's not working. He says, when in your life has everything worked out without him? Mm. I was like, yeah, no, it hasn't. So like, it kind of became this interesting conversation about like, how do I do that? What does it look like to have God as your business partner? So he's been a good business partner, man. It's worked well.
That's amazing. And when it comes to identity, which is what your book is all about, how do you think that shifted your identity when you decided to make God your business partner?
Yeah, you know, it's funny because it's a conversation I have. So I have a current pastor we chat all the time, and it's like, where does identity fit from a biblical standpoint? Because there's a biblical identity, you know, supposedly granted upon you, but then we're also given free will in life. Mm-hmm. So where's that bubble crossover? Like, where am I doing work I shouldn't do? And it's been a deep dive for me to figure it out. But the reality is because we have free will, we understand an identity given to us, like you still have the ability to craft and create an amazing identity. And I've been doing that all of my life. And I've lost it. I've completely lost a sense of who I was. After college, I went to the NFL and it was an interesting up and down. You know, my marriage was good and everything was great. Then I lost the NFL to injury and I lost myself. My marriage falls apart. I get divorced. I'm not a present father. I'm out of shape. The gym business is up and down and tanking. And so I lost all of what made me and was actually suicidal at one point. And I climbed out of that hole. And the climb out of that hole, at the time, I thought was like, I just worked real hard. But what it really was I was trying to align with the person I really wanted to be. Because a lot of us, we are a person that we are, and we accept for now. But if we're honest, it's not who we really want to be able to identify as. Like to the point where you will go to battle for yourself. You know, like that whole work in the dark to have what you deserve in the light. I think we as humans, we fight for what we believe we deserve. Mm-hmm. So if I believe I deserve it, I fight for it. And the cool thing is if it's up here, it's great. You'll fight. You won't settle for less. But if it's down here, you will fight to stay here. Mm. You'll self-sabotage, you'll remove yourself from situations, you'll secede when you shouldn't. Because, what if I get up here and someone pokes holes?
Right.
You're right? So there's this interesting aspect. And so for me, I came to find that identity played a massive role with faith and who I saw myself as a dad and as a husband. And what I just simply was like asking a question was who is the person that has these things I want? Mm-hmm. I want a great marriage. I want to be in great shape again. I want to have a business that serves people. I want to be a good dad. Like, okay, great. You can't just want that. Mm-hmm. It's not going to happen because you want it, right? You got to do certain things. And it's hard to do things if they aren't who you are.
Right.
Because it feels out of character. Mm-hmm. But the interesting thing is that's good. Because if your character isn't of the caliber for what your dream is, you need to expand your character, which means I got to shift into that person to where the things I do now is in the beginning, it was hard to do them because it's like, I know I messed up in the marriage. I know I wasn't a good dad. It was hard to do these things. They felt out of character, but then eventually it became hard to not do them.
And what were some of those things that you had to do?
I had to go have some deep conversations with like my kids and own up to like, hey, I'm not a great dad. In the marriage, I had to own up to my part in the marriage. You know, there's There's a lot of things that people will, you know, easily place blame on and cast it aside. And what happens is it continues to perpetuate in your life. Mm-hmm. The next relationship will start and in the same way over and over again, right? So for me, it's like, well, I'm not a good husband. Mm-hmm. I was very focused on.
So you just acknowledge it. You're like, I need to acknowledge the truth.
Yeah. Oh, that's yeah. Hard. And it's hard to do. There's a statement I love. It's hard to see the label when you're inside the jar. Mm. Like, I don't see it. But what happens, I keep dishing out that it's the same thing coming out of me. I can only give out what I have inside. And so if you never look at the label, you never change it. Mm-hmm. And so for me, it was a lot of going in and like, all right, I'm not a good husband.
Right.
And I understand that. And it's not that I was forever always going to be that way, but I understood that. In business, I didn't do a good job of taking in insights. Mm-hmm. I had this big football ego. I'm great. I know stuff. I used to play in the NFL. It doesn't mean anything. It just means I played a game. You know, it doesn't mean I understand marketing and advertising and sales and team management and product creation and offer. None of that.
Right.
And so what happens is we end up going in these spaces where we don't want to be met with the feeling of I'm not good. Mm. We've built this amazing tree of our identity, of what we have, this beautiful tree. And we expect to go plant a seed in the ground and have that tree come immediately. And the reality is it doesn't work that way. So what you end up doing is leaving this tree and you can't eat because you have no tree here. And then you go back to that tree. But this tree's rotting because it's the old part of your identity. So yeah, I learned a lot through the whole process of like life falling apart, the trees dying, and me sitting there like, I can't eat because I haven't built another tree.
Right. And what part do you feel like forgiveness played?
Massive piece.
Yeah.
Huge. Because for me, well, logically, it's the thing. If I go out into the world and I'm mad at people all the time, I'm going to get anger back, right? So I believe the world that we experience is a mirror to us heavily, right? So if I show up negatively, I get negative. If I show up positive, I get positive. Now I can only give out what I have inside. So if inside I have joy, I'm gonna give that out, it gets mirrored back, right? So with forgiveness, what I found is like, as long as I have that in me, mm-hmm. the life I get to experience isn't gonna be as great as I want it to be. Cause I'm just gonna give out this anger and disdain and I won't even notice it. The unique thing about identity is it's who you are when you aren't thinking about who you are.
Right.
It's just how you operate and you're in flow. So some people are just like, it's like, why are they like that? They don't even know they're like that. Mm. They just are. So what you do is you go back and say, well, how do I get that out? And the biggest thing is you got to get it out. And I think it happens emotionally, but also logically. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness is a weird mantra because like, I want to forgive, but I don't want you off the hook. Mm. You know, I want you to get yours. Is that revenge, mm-hmm. retribution, you know, kind of thing. And I was like, right. So I had, you know, a mom, a real mom. I had, you know, my real dad. I had my wife who had done some things in a marriage. I had people steal from me in business. I had friends that would just do some crazy things. And I couldn't make sense of it logically. Emotionally, I knew I didn't like it, but mm-hmm. the logic couldn't lead into me understanding it. So here's what I started to learn. I was like, well, at the end of the day, no one did anything to me intentionally to have like a malicious act take place. It wasn't like a malicious, Anthony, I want your life to be horrible. What right. it typically was them selfishly fulfilling a need, mm-hmm. and the byproduct was me experiencing something that sucked.
Right.
So I was like, first of all, they didn't even do it to purposely hurt me. Mm-hmm. They did it to help them. I just wasn't thought about. So that's one part. Second part,
I think
is
that's
like,
powerful too. I just want to acknowledge that. Like, because a lot of people feel like, you know, you hear it when we're young. They did this to me, or what are mm-hmm. they doing to you? Mm-hmm. But, you know, what you said is just like, they are fulfilling their own needs, yeah. not intentionally harming me, mm-hmm. but you being harmed is the byproduct. And yeah. I think just acknowledging that is very important because sometimes when you have the mindset of people are out to get you or out to yeah. attack
then you're angry.
Then that anger is just built inside of your
yeah.
DNA.
Yeah. And then you're so like, helpful. then you're trying to, how could you do this to me? Mm-hmm. How dare you do this to me? It's like, they weren't even thinking about you.
Right.
I mean, if anything, they were thinking about them 100%. So that was the first piece. And the second piece, like I think back to my mom, my real dad, like even my wife. It's like, you know what? Because we got divorced. We got married and got divorced for 3 years, got remarried. We're an amazing marriage now. But the reality of it was they weren't given tools. Mm. Like most people, like, I want you to not do this to me. How could you not? I want to make sense of it all. It's like that brain's not your brain.
Right.
They don't have those tools. Mm-hmm. So it's genuinely like kind of like, I'm going to be mad at a zebra for having stripes. Mm. So I was like, dang, you know, my biological mom wasn't raised in a way where she had the conscious tools to manage the situation or be a mom. So she thought she was doing good by giving us away.
Right.
She didn't know what was gonna happen to me in foster care. Mm-hmm. My real dad thought, you know what, if I'm in the picture, it's gonna be headaches for this kid, I'll just leave because his mom's gonna be around and take care of him. Mm-hmm. He didn't know. My wife was fulfilling a selfish need for herself and she wasn't even thinking about me and it's just only her. Like, But she grew up in a situation where her parents never really talked about anything. It was always hidden. So she had no tools to manage a marriage when it got difficult. Mm-hmm. People that stole from me in business, they just were trying to pay bills for the most part. Just that easy mark. And it wasn't this thing of like, get in, but it was like, I can get some other stuff with the dollars here. They didn't attach it to what would happen to my pocketbook or my life.
Right.
It's just like, man, and this is the logic. Phenomenally happy people don't do those things. Mm. That's it. If phenomenally happy people, they don't. So I found that when they do it, it's like I needed to give them more of compassion than I needed to give them anger. And in doing so, if I have a care, because you only hate people because you have a love for them. If I wanted to actually love in a positive way, I had to figure out, like, how do I compassionately help this person be better? And that was at the same time, like, forgiving from a logic point. And when you get the logic point of forgiving, it allows that person to become a better human in some capacity, possibly. But then also lets you off that emotional hook. So now I have, like, peace. Mm. So I can give peace to the world. I can experience a more peaceful world and everything rolls smoother.
That's powerful. That's so powerful. I think a lot of times people don't understand it's just a practice. Literally have to practice it. And it's not easy, because I'm sure there's some time when things came up and you're like, see, and you want to also label someone. When someone has hurt you, you want to write them off and say, well, that's just how they are. Yeah. So I'm very curious, because this rarely happens, that you get a divorce and you remarry the person that, you know, you were with in the beginning. So can you talk a little bit about that and how that transpired for you?
Yeah, we were separate, man. We had the whole kit and caboodle. Mm-hmm. Like, custody battles, arguments, the fiery text messages, all that same stuff. It was a situation where we had all the negative things you'd experience. Mm-hmm. But in that same experience, it's like you have this disdain when you start forgiving. Mm-hmm. You start realizing, like, what's that? I think Sun Tzu says something like, when you learn to understand your enemy, you start to love your enemy. Mm. Like, she was for sure my enemy. Like, you know, it was bad. I'm not gonna lie. It was really one of those real marriages that falls apart.
Right.
And then you get to the point of like, you know what? The more I try to shame her for her actions and what took place, the more that she's not showing up for my kids in a certain way as a great mom. She loved her kids to death, but she, you know, she'll tell you the truth. She wasn't the best mom at the moment in time. So I was like, what's the best way that I can help this? Because I can't help be better. But like, what if I remove the shame? Mm. What if I stop trying to bury her with that? Like, push back. So I did. I pushed back to a certain position and let her kind of blossom again. And what's interesting is when you do that, you're growing and letting that happen. It gives them a chance to grow. Mm-hmm. So when we were separate, I mean, first thing, we were 16-year-old kids that had a kid that went into real life in the NFL, bought house, you know, all this stuff. And it's like, we had no skill sets.
Right.
No one in our family had done this before. So it's like, you know.
You're figuring it out along the way.
The whole time. And then like the ego, it's just all this stuff ties in. And it's not an excuse, but it's a reality. It's almost like we were doomed from the get-go, you know, it's odd. Mm-hmm. Multiples, we had twins. The statistics for people having multiples and divorcing alone are high, let alone being the products of divorce, which makes it an even higher percent of a divorce. All of it was perfect web to fall apart. You could have sat on paper and be like, yeah, they're going to divorce at some point. So, but then we did. And then what happened is we both individually, but simultaneously, were working on each other. Mm. So like she had got this book that someone gave to her that was a Joyce Meyer's book. She woke up one day, she's like, I was hungover. It was, you know, I was by myself. I had no friends. I just felt like this can't be my life ongoing. I woke up one day, look in the mirror, like, this dude sucks. He's not a good dad. I just said none of his kids should even want to be with someone like him or aspire to be like him. I was like, something's gotta change. And we both kind of did our things. And then in a weird way, like timing was almost precise and perfect. Mm-hmm. That God like was like, here you guys go. You know,
like, let me put you back together now. Yeah, now you've individually figured it out. Wow, that's so beautiful. That
was it. So just it was cool. Now, are we perfect? No. Mm-hmm. We always have our, you know, we're a married couple.
Right.
We go back and forth, but there's never ever that thought of like, we're not going to be together. Mm-hmm. It doesn't creep in. It's weird. It doesn't, there's nothing. I can't think of the thing that would happen that would have it fall apart. Mm-hmm. I don't have trust issues. I have no issues. Neither does she. Like we move really smooth. We handle a lot of things amazingly well as a team, but it's cool what can be put back together when things have been broken if you actually choose to do it. And a lot of it comes down to who we chose to be as humans. Mm-hmm. I chose to be a better husband, better dad, better business owner. She chose to be a better mom as an identity.
Right.
And they match and it works.
And that's what I was going to ask you, like, how did you identifying yourself and her identifying herself help the marriage work? Because I know it had to be a huge identity acceptance when separately and then also when you're back together.
Yeah, it's I think it's the only way it would have worked. Because if not, I would have went into it saying like, oh, I'm this guy. You're going to have to deal with me as I am. And you hear that a lot. This is who I am. Take me at my best. Like, no, that's not your best if you're saying that. Mm-hmm. That's saying you're going to give me parts of you that I have to deal with.
Right.
And I'm like, I don't know if that's the healthy way to be in any relationship. I'm not saying you have to change that person by any means. Mm-hmm. But there should be a perspective of realizing we all grow as humans.
Right.
And if I'm going to choose to be in a relationship with you and I want you to do for me, I should also do for you. Mm-hmm. Now, in that ebb and flow, that you know, compromising of certain things, or maybe some things where like, I have certain things for me as a kid that it's hardwired. I try my best to adjust them, but I can't. However, I'm aware that when it happens and I'm triggered, I can adjust my response.
Right.
Because I know that if I don't, then I'm going to give you something you don't need, and then you're going to give me something I don't want. And then it goes, you know? So, but we can be aware of these, and that's just how I chose to identify. I am the guy that identifies as I'm adaptable as a human internally for my marriage. Mm-hmm. Not for my wife, for the marriage. So when I understand what my marriage needs, I can identify as a person in my actions who will give the marriage what it needs. Mm. And sometimes a marriage is needing something from me, not me needing something from her.
Right.
And so like that identification of who I am and how I show up, it's a constant ebb and flow that shows up.
That's a beautiful perspective, like thinking about the container versus the person.
Yeah.
You know, and what do you feel like it takes from a perspective of, you know, from your wife's perspective? What do you think her perspective is about her identity in the marriage?
She's a very type A human. Mm. Yeah, it's interesting. She's in a stage where she's had great success. And I feel like she's siloed in a space because she doesn't have like connections like we have in these outside amazing groups. Mm-hmm. And her identity, I think it's like she's understanding that she has far surpassed a lot of people in her life. Mm-hmm. Not in a way it's negative, right? It's just a way of like spiritually and financially and like her body. Like she does track now. She does master's track. She's veined up and ridiculous fast. It's so cool. But no, she actually sits in these spaces. And I think her identity now is like, how do I progress into the stage of, I think, fully experiencing and embracing all that I have without coming off cocky, but then also having like this space for more?
Right.
Right. Because there's a lot, I think, that she has a ton she has to give to the world, but that's got to be her journey to take. I love the statement of, you can't want more for someone than they want for themselves. Mm. So I don't want more for her, but I think like in this marriage and how we operate now, a lot of it's just, I think, and this might be all men-women relationships, maybe I'm wrong, but I feel like I'm really adaptable. I'm like, whatever, honey, whatever you want to do, right? Mm-hmm. It's not usually reciprocated in an opposite way all the time. Mm. Now, when she doesn't do it, I don't fly off the handle. I'm just you're aware that I did that. But like, can I get you to do this? You know, like it's not always reciprocated, but I don't have this, like I'm not keeping score, but I know that little by little we nudge, but that's just always been her. Mm-hmm. So while she does it, it's like, it may not be the most fun thing. It's like the thing is funny is the thing to love about a person you also hate about them. Mm-hmm. Like if you have a comedian, you probably love that they're funny, but I hate that you're funny when we're fighting. You know, like there's, and so for her, like the same things if she works on, like I don't want her to change, but I want her to be more aware of it in the moments of things taking place. So identity wise, I think she's in a stage of like relearning me, I think in certain aspects, because I continue to grow and learn and ebb and flow and build. But it's also me doing the same for her, but also doing it in a stance of like, it's okay if you don't want that right now.
Right.
Because if you don't want that, that's cool. But because I'm adaptable, we work. We have our conversations. So it's a little bit like this, up and down. But the cool thing is it's a bonded, glued, amazing relationship.
And it sounds like you fully accept her as she is.
Oh, yeah.
No matter how she changes, shifts and changes and grows. And it sounds like she is the same for you, just accepting as you grow and expand and shift and change. Yeah. Speaking of that, I know, you know, your book, Identity Issue, can you share how you help people make shifts in their life? Because we're all so different. We're all so uniquely different. And especially with, you know, everything that's going on in the world, people are really trying to figure it out. Mm. Like, who am I?
Yeah. The thing is interesting is people say like, I got to find myself, right? So this is my own perspective. I don't know if you find yourself, I think you build yourself.
Yeah.
And I think it's very doable. You may find things about yourself that you weren't aware were taking place, or you might find joy in, because I think when we're young, our vision's up here, then we get older and it gets tight, right? So I think you may find new nuances, but I don't know if you find a whole different person hiding inside of you, so to speak. You build that person. So in the book, what I did is I wanted to make sure like the concept made sense, right? Because if I can't get you to grasp the concept of why it's important, you don't care how to do it. So we've been talking about what the outcome is, which is great for a lot of people, but it's like, all right, cool. Isn't there other ways to get there? Yes, but they take longer. Some are more pain-ridden. And to be quite honest, we've already done what I'm talking about. Right. The fact that anybody's made it past any hardship, we've done it. We just did it unintentionally, haphazardly. So we kind of just got an outcome without thinking about it from an intentional standpoint. Mm-hmm. So once you get the concept in the book, there's a method we use called the shift method. Mm-hmm. So I guide people through what I figured out by trial and error and just research. And I created a process called the shift method that allows you to do this. Because mm-hmm. while we're all different, we all are human in the experience of it all.
Right.
We don't see things about ourselves. We mm-hmm. have to make actual actions take place to change our lives. And we have to keep some kind of consistency in place to become that person.
Right.
That's just the human condition, right? Mm-hmm. So as opposed to guessing through that and hoping I work real hard and it gets there, it's like, what if I codified a process to do that? So I did, and it works, and then I put it in the book. So I was like, here, as opposed to you like learning about identity, like most books will do, learn about it and then go figure it out. I was like, learn about it, but here's how you do it. Mm-hmm. So it actually walks you through the steps to do it.
That's amazing. So it's more practical.
Very
like
practical.
A, B, C, D. Yeah, that's really good. I think people need that because it's easy to say, go do it, you figure it out. And it's easy, more easier said than done if you really don't know, but how do I figure it out? Mm-hmm. And so tell me one of your best success story of like helping someone find their identity.
My man, Frank. Mm-hmm. We'll say his full name, Frank Benedetto, good dude. Mm-hmm. So Frank had sold a business for like $1 million, right? Mm-hmm. And that sounds like it wasn't all in his pocket. He got a portion of that between his partners and everything, and then, you know, paying off things. And so what ended up happening was he comes to me, he's like, look, I had a crazy process to get there. I sold that. He says, but you know what? After I actually made this money, I didn't feel like I deserved it. I felt like it was an accident. Mm-hmm. So when he came to me, he was making about $3,000 a month. He's like, I got to figure out I'd be able to get to this point of making, you know, like $20,000 a month, to be able to get back to my same lifestyle. And so we went through it. The funny thing is, Frank knew he could spit off what he needed to work on.
Right.
Most people can. They can tell you, this is what I should do, mm-hmm. right? But are they doing it's the question. He wasn't doing it. He didn't identify as a person who was making more money.
Right.
The identity didn't match the dream. Mm-hmm. So when we look at what we do in the book, like we craft that vision and say, what's the identity that has to match that and how do we shift into it? Mm. So fast forward, I want to say about a year and a half now. Mm-hmm. And he sent me a text message the other day. It was actually pretty cool. He's like, hey, I want to let you remember we started and like we're talking about $3,000 a month and making more. It's like, yeah, he goes, I just did the numbers. I have now surpassed $1,056,000 in the business.
Wow.
And it wasn't a bunch more information. Yeah. It wasn't like I gave him all these amazing strategies and tools. Mm-hmm. We just went through who are you with what you know? Because mm-hmm. once you understand like that's the key, doors open up. Nothing wow. stops you. You flow and it's smooth and it gets to a point of what I call effortless effort. Because mm-hmm. the effort we give, like we're going to give effort. We, as humans, love to give effort. But if it's draining my soul because it's not who I am, right. I'll burn out. However, if it's who you are, those exact same actions will fill you up.
Mm-hmm. That's so true. I think that's one of the things that people, especially when it comes to being an entrepreneur, they realize that if you're doing too many things that don't serve your highest purpose, mm-hmm. it'll be draining.
It will.
But as soon as you align yourself with what fulfills you and what's in alignment with your purpose, you're like, I can do this all day. Why am I not tired?
Yeah. Exactly, man.
That's amazing.
A fun thing. Like my wife, she looks at me, she's like, how do you just talk all day? I'm like, I love talking. She's like, I couldn't do it. I'm like, I know, it's okay, but love me as I am and I'll love you as you are.
That's awesome. Well, you're in incredible shape, you know, and our second mm-hmm. pillar of Get Lived Up is well-being. So can you share kind of like your wellness regimen that you do to stay energetic and in top shape?
Yeah, big thing is the body is not designed to carry the brain around. Mm. You got to kind of use it. And actually done right, it fuels the brain. So I can stay focused longer. I'll get on stages. I'll do, you know, the talking and then go hold coaching calls and then still record podcasts and then do all of it. And it's not this thing that drains me. So that's the first part. I love doing it. There's a space where I think if you get to do something you love and people love that you do it, it's a cool little spot. But then also take care of my body. So I found that I have a degree in kinesiology. I owned a gym for a decade, but I pay somebody else to write my workouts. Mm. So things that I don't want to spend mental energy on,
right?
I don't do. So I don't want to spend mental energy on writing my workouts. I want working out to be like a meditation. Mm. So I need to just be able to look at a sheet of paper, know the reps, and then just headphones in and go.
Nice.
And so like that's how I've designed that whole aspect of my regimen to where I don't think about it and I get to actually output and give great flow. But in doing so, like I feel good, here's the thing, at the end of the workout, when I wanted to quit halfway, and I never have, you get to the end and go, man, I love you. Because that's the big thing I think I didn't have for a while. I was like, I didn't love Ant. And if you think about it, like, if you don't love somebody, you don't show up for that person.
Right.
You don't do the hard things for that person. Mm. And so, like, I had to get to the point of first respecting me because of the work I did, and then respect you get some love. Because I don't know anybody I love that I don't respect. You know what
right.
I mean?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I get to that point of, like, I have this in between. It's like, boom. And so that I do the hard work. I respect. I love. I show up. And then it keeps my attention and focus dialed in.
Right.
And then I just feel good about myself, that I could actually experience life, too. Because if I couldn't, like, go and walk and run and bounce around with my kids like that, I would not experience the full breadth of life, what it is. So it's a humongous piece for me.
I love that. I love that you said that. It really does start with self-love and self-respect.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you love and respect yourself, you take care of yourself, you do what needs to be done, whatever it is. Like you said, you have the degree. You could write your own, but you get someone else to do it because you know that's a need.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, sometimes we shame ourselves and guilt ourselves like, oh, I should be able to do that and I should be, you know, but really it's about what brings you the most joy.
Yeah.
Like, what do you like doing? And if you want to outsource something, even though you can do it, do it, you know, and you giving yourself permission to, that's absolutely amazing. I think a lot of people are going to look and say, you know what? I'm not really loving myself if I'm not taking care of myself, if I'm not giving myself what I need.
Yeah.
And then our last pillar is entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm.
We're here together at a mastermind, both a part of Growth Day with Brendon Burchard and so many amazing entrepreneurs. What has been your catalyst for turning this passion and this desire in just a book? Because a lot of people have a book.
Mm-hmm.
What has been your catalyst to making this a really successful business?
I think it was knowing my thing, right? It'd be funny, honest, nobody knows this, but this, we're here now.
Mm-hmm.
It started around a campfire in Wyoming where the conversation of identity popped up. So this exact same thing, what, 4 years ago was the catalyst to me understanding what my unique thing is. So Ethan, who I wish he was here, but he's not, he explained to me the message and the messenger.
Hmm.
If you're the messenger, but you don't have the right message, it won't land. With the right message and the wrong messenger, it won't land.
Hmm.
So I had a different message before, but he was like, that's not your message.
Hmm.
You're the messenger. You can talk and share like you have this experience, but that's the wrong message. So identity kind of came in through his guidance and the group of people here. I was like, oh, that's the thing. And then once you have your thing, it's kind of like when you feel, like if you have like a kid, what do they do when they catch like a, you know, like a firefly? Here, look, right?
Yeah.
I got this cool thing. Once you're like, oh, this thing is cool. The rest of the world should see it. And it comes out of you and it flows in a way that's easy because it's who you are.
Right.
Oh man, it just goes. And so now people go, how do you do that? I'm like, I don't know how I don't do it. I don't know. There's nothing else in this world I could be doing. So it led into me saying, well, there's value here.
Mm-hmm.
If I give it to the world in a way that allows them to benefit from it, great. Also, when people invest in themselves, they pay attention to a higher level. They get way better results. It's like, well, everybody wins because people do not want like to be sold. And I'm not a big, I don't want to sell you anything, but they like to buy things.
Mm-hmm.
I like to buy things, but I don't want to feel like you make me buy it, you know?
Right.
So I find that when people want to buy, if I can create something that would be beneficial for their life, that they would want to buy and apply, and I want to give it, synergy happens.
Mm.
Amazing things take place. And then I get to be in a place where I get to do something I love. People love that I do it. And it creates a space in my life of control and freedom so I can be thoroughly fulfilled while living my life, continue to learn lessons because I still live life, and then continue to keep sharing those lessons as I get them.
I love that. That's amazing. I could talk to you forever. Thank you so much for just kind of sharing your life and your life's journey. I think it's going to help so many people who are trying to find their identity and trying to find their self-worth and self-love. And so is there anything you'd like to share with people that you haven't shared already?
No, go buy the book. Go get the book, put in your life.
We got it right here.
It right
identity
there.
Shift.
Yeah.
Upgrade how you operate to elevate your life.
Yeah. If you guys go grab that, and I'll give like a free, I give just like a bunch of free gifts. Because the thing is, I want the book to be something people can grab and actually apply. So they go to identityshiftbook.com and then use the code BOOKBONUS. They'll actually get a whole bunch of cool things like the audio book. I recorded it myself, which was, it was kind of fun. It was actually, I didn't like in the moment, but when I was done, I was like, that was cool, you know?
Mm.
But then also the digital book, for those who are using their phone, and also a workbook that ingrains all the stuff we talk about in the book.
That's amazing. I think that's such an amazing bonus, amazing gifts. Y'all go out and get it. And where can they find you? Where are you at on in the social?
All over the place. I'm the only one besides my son that's the name Anthony Trucks, but I spend most time on Instagram.
Thank you so much for coming on. It's been so amazing to have you. And you all, until next time, love yourself, love others, and love the world. One day at a time, one breath at a time.
I just want to take a moment to say thank you for being part of the Get Loved Up community. I like to share topics and people making a positive impact in the world, and your feedback means the world to me. If you haven't already left a review, please leave a 5-star review and let me know what you want to hear more of on the show. I'm here for you, and together we're making the world a better place, one day at a time, one show at a time. Thank you for listening.